topic, but most of pretty everybody probably heard it before. But the proof is in the pudding, and I was just thinking about that, and just thinking about what it actually means. Is an expression that people say to find that said the best way to find out if something is good or successful is either to try it out or to test it. And so, thinking about that tonight, I was led to the scripture, 2 Timothy 2 and 15. And it just was kind of a good thought of thinking about the proof is in the pudding and how we have to get into the Bible and get into God's Word and study in order to show ourselves approved and in order for us to have the strength that we need. And so in tonight's scripture, right at 14, I'll start there. It says, "Of these things, put them in remembrance, charging them before the Lord, that they strive not about words to no profit, but to the subverting of the hearers." It says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." And so thinking about rightly dividing the word of truth and understanding that what word is needing and when it's needing and how to rightly divide the Bible is what he's speaking about, and understanding that we have to study to show ourselves approved unto God. And I was thinking about when we try to show ourselves approved by things, and we want to show ourselves approved by houses and cars, that we'll take someone into the house. We'll take a drive in the car to approve ourselves by that. And even thinking about the pudding and food, if something is good, we'll want to taste it and we'll want to have others to taste it, and we'll be excited by that. And so I thought about how God is and how the Word is. And so even and how good it is, we still see people struggle to go and run after it as they would for good dishes and things like that. But he's telling them to show itself approved unto God. And so if we have to do that, we have to get with God and get in his will and spend some time with God in order for that to happen. And so what he's saying, Paul is talking to Timothy, and he's talking to him as a son in the Gospels, and understanding the time that Paul was in. He was writing these story or these passages from being in prison, and at this point in time, he doesn't know if he's going to make it, and he thinks he's getting ready to die. So he sends for Timothy to be able to give him the to-do list for the kingdom, and he sends for him, understanding who Timothy was. He sent for him to give him this call, to give him the list that was set forth for the kingdom and for the things that were to come forth to happen. And so as we understand that he had told him that he fought his good faith and he had kept the fight, we understood that Paul was talking about himself, but he was trying to get Timothy to understand this in a way to understand what was coming, to understand that all these things that he had went through, that he had learned how to be abound and abase. He had learned how to be full and empty. He had learned how to become the person of God after going through all of these different things. And so he's talking to Timothy because he's giving Timothy the lead to where now he's sending him out and giving him the lead of the people, and he's trying to instruct him to how to lead and what to do. And we see right when he starts to tell him what will happen, he starts to give him the ideas and the things that will happen when the perilous time came, meaning the time of destruction, the hard time came. And I want to get to some of those things, but I want to read right at Timothy, right before we got to 2 and 15, right at 2 and 10. He said, "Therefore I endure all things for for the elect's sake, that they may also obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory." And so understanding what we're trying to obtain and this salvation that we're going after, that we have to endure all of these things, and we have to go through understanding who Paul was. He had learned how to be content within no matter what stage he was in, because he understood that he was pressing toward the mark of the high calling, and he had went forth and he had endured these things, and he was able to now write some things and do some things to turn some things around. And he's writing to Timothy, and he tells him that it is a faithful saying, for if we be dead with him, we shall also live with him. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he shall also deny us. It says, if we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. And so understand, Paul is trying to get Timothy to look at some things in a different light, and to get him to move in a different way, because he's trying to get him to be ready to lead the people and to go forth and to remember the works of God, and to remember how God had given us not the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and of a sound mind, understanding how we're to move and to think. Things should be sound in our mind, meaning that it should be in harmony. It should be in order, that the steps of a good man are ordered by God. And so understanding these things, right at the beginning of 2, he said, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And so even understanding Philippians 4:13, that where our strength is, that we do all things through Christ, which strengthens us, that he's trying to get Timothy to know this just a little bit better, because there'll be some things that come, and he has to be strengthened in this aspect. And Paul is trying to get him to understand this in a bit deeper way. And he's saying that all the things that thou hast heard of me, many witnesses the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also, that thou endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. And so he was trying to get him to see this now as a soldier of Jesus Christ. And he had went through talking about a couple of different types of things, but he even talked about the labor, and he was talking about people that were willing to go through some things for something that was bigger than them, and they were willing to put in some sacrifice and some time that would produce some things that would bless something or somebody more than them. And so Paul is speaking, and he's speaking from a point of looking at himself at the end, and he's trying to build this on Timothy. And so he starts to talk to Timothy, and he tells him to flee all of his youthful lusts. And right in 22, he says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. He said, but foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And so understand, he was trying to get him to know what the word learned was. It meant to learn by experience, and understand going through some things, we can learn in our experience and in our trials and tribulations, and trusting God, we can learn how strong our faith can be, and how powerful God is when we put our faith and our trust in God, and we start to go through and learn in these situations. And he said that in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledgings of the truth. And so when we acknowledge the truth, is when our repentance starts to work. And so it started with, he's turning him to, he has to acknowledge some things in himself. And once he acknowledged these things, there'll be some things that change, and there'll be some things that happen. And even in the beginning, when Paul was talking, he was talking about Jesus being a source of power at the beginning. We see how this starts to open up, and what he'll say to Timothy, and he's saying that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. And so understanding that the will of the devil, meaning that they're following after the things, and the spirits are taken over. And after this happens, That there'll be some things that happen. And so I'm saying that you can recover yourselves out of the snare of the devil and who have taken them captive by their will, by the things that they're doing have been set inside, and now they're following this. And he's telling him to do away with these things, because these youthful lusts, we learned that sin full grown is death. And he's trying to get him to understand this in a time to where he's setting him forth to lead. And chapter 3, when he starts to talk about the perilous time, we see he starts to name some things, and he starts to get specific. And as I started to go through this and think about how the proof is in the pudding, and how not only do we have to get into the Word of God, and we have to go through our situations trusting God, but even when he started to talk about these specific things, they had a correlation with now and understanding the perilous times. He said in 3, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. It says, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. And so understand, and when we say this and what he's talking about, it's so amazing, because right now and the time that we're in, in the days that we're in, if we read and look through these things, that he starts to name, and he starts off with love of their own selves, and covetous and boasters, and how we see people boasting and bragging, and boasting meaning that people are acting like they have something that they really don't have, or acting like things are in a way, but they're really not. And as we see media and things like that, we see this happening. It's talking about people to be proud and blasphemers and disobedient to parents, and even being a teacher and understanding how disobedient the children are now, and how disobedient, even when if we look at it from the children of God aspect, that the children are, that we see these things. And he says, unthankful, and understanding how people are unthankful, and they don't appreciate things, and how this world has turned into this exact passage. And he says, unholy. And so he's naming all of these things specifically. And he's saying without natural affection. And so it says truce breakers, false accusers, incontent, fierce, despisers of those that are good. And so he's speaking about despising of those that are good, and people that are trying to make things that are good look bad, and despise of those things. And this looks just like, if we understand today's time and today's world, he said traitors and heady, high-minded, heady meaning to be headstrong and to be forceful, to where people just want what they want, and people want their way no matter what, and they're not lovers of God and the things that God has set forth. And then we see lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. And he's saying lovers of things of this world, and lovers of the things that this world have to give. And natural affection is the normal feelings of love for fellow man. Incontinent refers to the lack of self-restraint. Heady, it means to be reckless. And see, we understanding when we look at today's society and we look at how things are going, we see a lot of this, and we see how this looks. And it's saying that having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. And so when he's speaking about having a form of something, which means you're in a form of something and it looks like something, he's saying, but not having the power, but denying the power of what it looks like, meaning where it's formed like something, but it doesn't have the power of what it's formed like. And he's saying, from such turn away, and understanding that this turn away is if it's in a form, but it has no power, that people will turn away, that things will turn away. And he's saying, for of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts. And so he's speaking to him, and he's trying to get him to understand this in a bit deeper way. And he said, ever learning and never able to come to knowledge of the truth. And he said that always learning and always studying and always in the book and always I'm learning the God, learning, reading the Bible, but never coming to knowledge of the truth and knowledge of the real and knowledge of the substance of the word and understanding that the form but denying the power. It's almost like a dish that looks good, but it's not good. And understand when we think about the proof is in the pudding. If we go to eat into a piece of pie or some pudding and it looks good, and you bite into it and it's not good, it's much worse than if I would have looked at it and it didn't look good. Because even if I would have not tried it, or I would have already been expecting that it wasn't good. But we understand that when something looks good, we're expecting it to be good. But he's talking about I'm having a form of something, but not being in total substance and total of the thing. And he's saying learning, but having not the knowledge. And so we understand, and he mentioned even the two with Moses there, and he was talking about the corrupt mind, and he was trying to get him to remember how these men came forth in the beginning, and they had did some tricks, but he was trying to get him to understand the knowledge of the truth and the knowledge of God, and the power of this that came with this knowledge, and he started to speak to him. And in 10, he said, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, my manner of life, my purpose, my faith, my long suffering, my charity, and my patience. And so Paul is speaking to me, telling him that you know me, and you've seen me go through this, and you've seen my life, and you've seen what I've had to go through, and you've seen my persecutions and my afflictions. He said, persecutions and afflictions which came unto me at Antioch. He said, and I endured these things, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. And so this is the one thing that we have to remember: out of all of the things that we go through, and out of all of the things that we have to endure, that the Lord has delivered us. But Paul is speaking to Timothy to get him to understand this. And he named all of these things that he went through. And even at the end of this, Paul is trying to get us to understand that if we're going to be a disciple, if we're going to follow God, and if we're going to walk in righteousness, there's going to be some things that happen. And he says that, yea, and all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. And so we have to understand living a life of Christ-like and living a life in God and living godly in Christ Jesus, that we'll suffer some things. And it says, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. And so understanding, thinking about people that's trying to work your system, after a while you get tired of it, and people can mess up their blessing. Because we think about Jehoram and how he had a spirit of trying to work the people. And if it wasn't for Jehoshaphat, he wouldn't have even been able to get what he needed, wouldn't have been able to get it worked, because people get tired of their system being worked. And what he's telling him is that he said that these people that think that they're getting over, that the truth will come. And once the truth comes, that you could potentially mess up a blessing. But he's telling him that to continue in these things which thou hast learned and thou hast been assured of whom knowing them has learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. And so he's telling him about these scriptures that he's known, and he's telling him to stay with these scriptures and to get inside of these scriptures, because these scriptures is what will keep you wise, and they will make you wise unto the salvation, because this salvation is what we're trying to get. And he said that these scriptures is what will make us wise enough to understand and get our salvation, which is through our faith, and understanding that without our faith it's impossible to please God, but through our faith, which is in Christ Jesus. And so he said that all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. And so he had given us right there what this Bible, what the scriptures, and what it was for, and what it was to be used, and what the call of it was for. And he said that it was to be used for the reproof, for correction. And so as we start to learn the Bible, and as we start to get into it, and it starts to work on our heart, the thing in the middle of us that starts to turn everything, we see some correction, and we see our flesh start to line up with our spirit. And he said, for instruction in righteousness. And so when we want to do righteous, and when we want to line up, and when we want to find ourselves doing righteous, that we'll line up with the word of God, and that we'll find ourselves in the scriptures for what he said was by the inspiration of God. And so thinking about the inspiration, something that was inspired by God, it's something that's unthinkable. And so when he said all scripture is given, it says by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, is for reproof, for correction, and the instruction of righteousness. It says that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And so after we come through to this point to where we've been able to endure some things, and we went ahead and went forth, and we understood how Paul did, how to be content in every situation, no matter what situation it was, how to still know who God was, and how to know that we could help and still need help, that it was in his darkest moment, in his most vulnerable moment, even his most difficult moment, when the love of Jesus, it became more tangible, and his faithfulness, it became more tangible and more real to Paul, because in this moment there were some things that happened, and he had to come to a place to where he thought he knew that this was it, and it was over, and he had been through so many things, he had fought so many battles and won, he had went so far, but he knew that at this time, that this was probably the last time, and at this point things started to get just a little bit different, and he coming he's at 4 and 6 when he started to speak, and he told him to preach the word. He told him that to say, preach the word, be instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. And he said that even before, he says, charge ye therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall make the quick and the dead at his appearing, and his kingdom. And so understand that it's going to be some judging. It's going to be some things happening. He's trying to give us a wake-up call, to give us to sound some things for so that we can understand this and start to line up. He said, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. And so he was trying to get them to see that there'll be some times coming to where they won't endure sound doctrine, that they'll turn away because it's too hard, that they won't be willing to go through the times, and they won't be willing to trust God until he comes, that they won't be willing to endure this, and that they won't do it, that because it'll be too much to endure. And he said that but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And it's so understanding that he's trying to get them, they're looking for somebody to confirm what they think and to confirm how they feel. But we have to understand that this word has truth in it. And in this truth, we can be free and we can line up. But he said, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and they shall be turned into fables. But watch, thou in all things endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. And so understand that as he's departing and as he's getting ready to leave, he's trying to leave some things there. He's trying to leave some plans, and he's trying to leave somebody in charge, because he understood that before this, that there were some false teachers that had came along, and there were some people that was there, and Paul knew this, and he understood some things in a different way, and he was trying to talk to Timothy to get him to understand how to be strong, and how to have his faith set, and how to have his to have his benefits set in a place to where he could reap these things, because he knew what was coming, and he knew already, because we see when he found them, we knew that Paul had knew his mom and his grandma, and Paul knew some things about Timothy, and he knew Timothy in a different way. And so it was Timothy that he called, and he wrote this personal letter to him, and he said, at this time I'm ready to be offered up. He said that he was pouring out himself to Timothy. He said, I'm ready to be offered up so that I can pour out what I have to you. And he said, my departure is at hand, and I have fought a good fight, and I have finished my course, and I have kept the faith. And he said, henceforth, that there was a crown of the righteousness that was laid up to him. And he said, that which the Lord, so the righteous judge shall give me at that day, and not only to me, but unto them, but also that love his appearing. And so understanding that what Paul was trying to get Timothy to understand some things in a different way, and he was trying to talk to him in a way to where he could be ready for what was coming next, and so he could understand his strength and what he had in front of him. And so Paul had brought some things there, and Paul was trying to get him to understand that his proof was in the pudding, and that only way for him to understand who he was, that the only way for his power to work in the right way, the only way for things to start to move in the direction that they needed to is when he started to line up, and when he stayed strong in this, and he had to study in a way that he had to show himself approved, and he had to get into the word and start to become one with God and start to understand himself in a different way. And see, when we start to show ourselves approved, like I said, I start to think about approving ourselves by different things and by the cars and by houses. When we tell somebody, I just got this nice house and it looks so good, we want to show them the house, and we want to show them whatever the thing is, and we see we are approved by going into that thing, and we are approved by going and showing them that thing. And so even understanding how when Jesus came and he told them that if you don't eat my body and drink of my blood, that you won't have a part with me. And he was talking about the flesh and the blood. And we understand that he was trying to get them to be complete in their faith and complete in their body. And he was talking about the body because that's the flesh and the blood. And so we understand that Jesus was trying to get us to understand that the proof was in the pudding, that when we eat the bread and we remember the body, we understand that the proof is in the pudding, because there's some things that's in that body that we don't have in ours. And when we do that, we come to a complete stage, and we do this in a remembrance of Jesus and understanding of what Jesus did. And see, we know now in a different way that there's some things that happen. And so I keep thinking about even the story where they left out naked and bleeding. And so when I think about that, it just keeps helping me to see more of how we have to be in our word, and more of how we have to have our power to where we know that, and we can just move there, and I can kind of end with that. But in Acts 19 and 16, we see some things happen. And so I'll just read that. And so as we go there, it's just so amazing, because I start to think about our scriptures and things. And so as I started to think about this, and I started to think about these scriptures and how things have went on this, when we get to this point, we see at 19 and 16, we see that it says that, and the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them, so they fled out of the house naked and wounded. And so it's just naked and bleeding and another version, but I want to read the part before this, and it just talks and it teaches us why we have to be in our word, and why we have to have our strength and everything intact, so that when we start to speak to these spirits and we start to speak to these things, that some things will be moved, and that some things will work in our way and in our favor. And at 11, it says, and God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. And it says, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs of aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. And so we understand that there were some miracles that were done by Paul and that were worked by Paul. And it says, then certain of the vagabond Jews, exorcists, look upon them to call over them which had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, We adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preacheth. And so what I want to show you here is that they're trying to speak to some spirits, and they're trying to do some things with a secondhand anointing, with a secondhand power. And so that they're trying to talk to some spirits. It says, we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preacheth. And so we have to understand that we can't use nobody else's power. And so we see them trying to use the power that Paul had and that Paul preached by. And it says that, and after they said this, that they speak into the spirit, and they told him that we adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches. But it says, and there were seven sons of one Sceva, a Jew. It says, and chief of the priests, which did so. It says, and the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus, I know. It says, and Paul, I know, but who are ye? And so when we think about that, he didn't stop there to say that's only who I know, but he says, I know Jesus and I know Paul. He said, but I don't know you. And so we have to understand our proof is in the pudding, that until we go through some things and until we get strengthened in some ways and until we start to build ourselves in some ways, that when we speak to these spirits, that our name has some power, and we're not speaking on a second name basis. We're not using somebody else's strength to try to speak to these spirits, that we have to understand that we have to bear our own cross, as Jesus said. But he said the spirit spoke back and said that Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are ye? And it says, and the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them. And so understand it. It says, and the man in whom the evil spirit was, it said it leaped on them and overcame them and prevailed against them. So they fled out of the house naked and wounded. And so understanding tonight that we have to understand our proof, and we have to know where our power is, or that when these spirits have come and when these things come, that there'll be some things that won't happen like we wanted to. There'll be some things that move in the direction that we don't want it to happen. And so understanding that we can't speak with a second name basis, because the spirits asked them, who were they? Because they were speaking by Jesus whom Paul preached, which means they didn't know Jesus. They didn't have a real relationship with Jesus. That they were speaking to him by whom somebody else knew who he was. And so we have to understand and know God and know Jesus for ourselves, and not just know him, but have a relationship and have a personal relationship to where we are learning by experience, and we're learning by going through some things, and we're learning by letting God show us who he is and how strong he is, and having our faith intact and in the right places. And when this happens and we understand where our proof is, and we start to eat and we start to understand how good this dish is, we will want to share it with somebody else, and we'll be running to other people to get them to taste it, and we'll understand more of how the proof is in the pudding. And even in Timothy, when he was speaking, he was trying to get him to understand that the reason why he had to be such a good teacher was for the ears of the listeners. He didn't want him to overthrow the ears of the listeners and what the people were hearing. He didn't want their faith to be overthrown, because he understood that the failure to believe, it builds a lapse in our trust with God. And when we don't, we're not fed the right way, and when our word is not divided the right way, that the faith of the people will start to lapse. And if our faith lapse, then our trust in God will start to lapse. And the moment that happens, we'll see more of what we see in the world, and we'll see people going after lust of themselves and after the world and after the things that the world has, because the word is not rightly divided to them, to where they can see some things. And so what he was trying to get them to understand, that it was for the ears of the hearer. And so tonight's message, understanding that our proof is in the pudding, that we have to get in this, and we have to eat it, and we have to get into it as if it was a good bowl of pudding, and it's so good that I can't stop. And I found my proof. I found something that I know is good, and I can keep eating it. And I know that this won't run out, because Jesus told us that he was the bread and the life, and he had came for us to be the bread of life. And we just have to understand how to eat it and how to find our proof in the pudding, and how to get deep enough to where we're willing to share it, and we're excited to tell somebody else. And understanding tonight's message, and how we have to get into it, to where once we get into it, as Paul was trying to show Timothy, that there'll be some things that happen, but we have to get into our proof and into our pudding, to where we can see how good it is. And after we see how good it is, and we understand that our proof is in the pudding, I guarantee that you won't stop, and you won't stop eating, because your strength and your faith and everything will start to work in ways like never before. So tonight, understand that your proof is in the pudding.